Hello, my name is Bill Buell. I'm a reporter with the Daily Gazette here in Schenectady. We're at the Schenectady County Historical Society today to talk to Hudson Valley Community College history professor Matt Zembo. Matt, tell us where you're from originally and when you developed an interest in history and railroads specifically.
Railroads specifically. Well, I'm from Saratoga Springs, New York. I grew up there and close to the Saratoga battlefield, so it's probably where I really got my interest in also going to Lake George and seeing Fort William Henry. But I have an interest in military history and railroad history and industrial history, and then with the railroads I got interested by coming to Schenectady and learning that the factory I kept driving by all the time used to be the biggest locomotive factory in the world, actually. And I've really been into trains since for about 15 years now. And so.
Did you always want to be a history professor?
Since I could remember, yes. And so, a military history professor at that. So.
What kind of degree did you get and where did you go to school?
I did my undergraduate at ACC for my associates, BAs at SUNY Albany, and then I did my Master's in War Studies at the University of London, King's College. Kind of working on a PhD at the moment, SUNY. So.
And you teach history at Hudson Valley Community College. What kind of history?
I teach Western Civilization 1 and 2. I teach U.S. History 1, Introduction to Terrorism, which is not a methods class, it's a history class.
That's good.
And I teach World War II.
Let's talk a little bit about railroads. Why don't we start off by you telling us what the Mohawk Hudson Railroad was and what the DeWitt Clinton was?
Let's see, the Mohawk Hudson Railroad was a connecting railroad from Albany to Schenectady. And it was designed to basically take some time off of passenger travel. If you were trying to travel westward on the Erie Canal, it took forever to go from Albany up to Cohoes and from Cohoes to Schenectady, where I think, I can't remember the exact time, but it was like half a day to take the Mohawk and Hudson Railroad to Schenectady and then pick up a passenger ferry, or not ferry, canal boat westward. So it was, New York State was not happy with the introduction of railroads, I can definitely say that. Mainly because they had a vested interest in the Erie Canal and the railroads were direct competition. But it was a big deal when the Mohawk and Hudson was allowed to be created.
And the DeWitt Clinton was the initial railroad, the initial steam locomotive that carried the initial railroad from Albany.
Yeah, the DeWitt Clinton was one of the first steam locomotives in the country.
And that would have been September of 1831, I think?
Don't remember the exact dates. It's not my, that's not my actual area of expertise when it comes to that stuff, but I know that the Mohawk and Hudson was one of the oldest railroads in the country, or one of the first railroads in the country. Mm-hmm. So the oldest being the Baltimore and Ohio.
The Schenectady Locomotives, Schenectady Locomotive Works, was the proper name, right? And when did that start? What was that all about?
It was incorporated before it actually opened, but it actually opened for business as in producing locomotives in 1848. And it was wasn't the biggest locomotive producer in the world, but over time it became one of the better locomotive producers in the country. For example, the Jupiter, which was one of the trains that you see in the picture, the Transcontinental, when they're meeting, the Jupiter was a Schenectady Locomotive Works locomotive. They also produced for the United States Army and the U.S. government probably over 300 locomotives, I think, during the Civil War. They grew to be one of the, like I said, a quality producer, and they had an engineer named Walter McQueen, and there's a certain type of locomotive that actually became known as the McQueen, and other locomotive producers actually copied it, you know, the designs as well. So,
who was John Ellis?
John Ellis was a Schenectady resident who was the first president of the company, and a local businessman that obviously invested in the Schenectady Locomotive Works. The Ellis family ended up dominating the Schenectady Locomotive Works until the very end. I think there was still an Ellis who was president when they were sold to ALCO, American Locomotive Works, in 1905.
So their right-hand man, so to speak, was Walter McQueen, and he was responsible for the technology.
Yeah, the Ellis family was more into the business side, of things, from what I understand. And but Walter McQueen was the engineer. And as a matter of fact, Walter McQueen was so famous for his designs that there were people, I think it was in the 1870s, who tried to steal him away from the Schenectady Locomotive Works. So they built another locomotive works on the other side of Schenectady that they were going to turn into the McQueen Works. And he ended up, I don't know, probably some backdoor deals that we don't know fully about, But he ended up staying with Schenectady Locomotive Works, but those buildings were built and remained empty. And then, as you know, they became the home for General Electric Company. So.
What happened in 1904? Or 1901, I'm sorry.
1901. I said 1905 when I said when ALCO was created. What happens with the creation of ALCO is that there were dozens of producers of locomotives throughout the country. And surprise, surprise, J.P. Morgan decides that he wants to compete with the Baldwin Locomotive Works in Philadelphia. And he essentially bought, him and a group of investors bought a whole bunch of different locomotive works around the country. There's like the Manchester Works, there was the Rogers Works over in Providence, Rhode Island, Richmond Works in Richmond, Virginia. And I think in the end there ended up being like 8 different locomotive producers that started as ALCO. And basically what they do is they form one big corporation. And when you combined all these companies, they were the biggest locomotive producer in the world. They actually outstripped Baldwin in size and production. What ends up happening over the early years of the company, though, is a lot of those original companies, their works were older. Mm-hmm. You know, so it was difficult and costly to produce locomotives. And so what ends up happening is Schenectady Locomotive Works was the company that had spent the most on infrastructure within their buildings and production menu, you know. And what ends up happening is the Schenectady Locomotive Works is the most modern, and so that ends up being the headquarters, kind of like the main factory for the American Locomotive Company. And as the 1920s, you know, develop, and then obviously into the Depression, but even before the Depression, like the other outer companies, like, you know, the other locomotive works that made up ALCO were starting to close down because the Schenectady, they kept investing more in Schenectady than any of the other plants.
So the merger kind of saved a number of those other companies?
For a while, and then, you know, like for, there was a locomotive company in Pittsburgh and stuff, and they were producing into the 20s that were part of ALCO. Mm-hmm. But, you know, these companies were smaller, and over time, the investment was in the Schenectady plant and not these other plants, so they started to shut down, and Schenectady essentially became the home of the American Locomotive Company.
When we drive out Maxim Road these days and look to our left if we're driving out of town, we can see a number of old factory buildings. Do you have any idea how different it looks today than it looked back in 1920, 1910?
It looks a lot different. The Erie Canal, of course, at one point went through there, and then they closed that. In the 1920s, the main production area was actually on the other side of the Delaware and Hudson Railroad, over on Knott Street, and in there where they're building the Gold headquarters at the moment. That actually was the more important area for production. And then you had Building 62, which was another area of production, which is actually still there. When you drive and you look to your left, you know, when you're driving towards the Mohawk River, Building 62 is the big one with the big cupola, mm-hmm. and it still says American Locomotive Works. If you really look hard, it's still bleeding through. They tried to paint over it. But that was probably one of the other main buildings that was important for production as well.
So. What was the role of ALCO during World War I and then World War II? We're always associating it with steam locomotives, but they did build other things, didn't they?
In the early years, yeah, they tried to invest in building automobiles. As a matter of fact, the American Locomotive Company trucks were considered some of the best trucks in the country. And the problem, though, is they weren't profitable at the time. I think what happened was, as some people argue, that if ALCO had waited a couple of years and took a few more years of losses, their trucks would have taken off and they would have become one of the major, not only a locomotive producer, but a major automobile producer as well. Mm-hmm. But they gave up on that. So that was prior to World War I. During World War I, of course, they're still building steam locomotives because they're already the largest steam producer in the world at that time. And the United States Railroad Administration took over and basically told railroads what they could buy as far as steam locomotives were concerned. And then the other thing that the government did in World War I is it said, these are the type of locomotives that every single locomotive company can build. So they were all building the same exact stuff, you know, so like, you know, there was certain types of switchers, everybody built the same switcher, and then, you know, right up to the bigger engines. That was because of the war. They didn't want to waste resources, and basically the other thing is, too, is that the railroads were taken over by the United States government during World War I. They were run by the U.S. government, so they didn't really care, you know, what kind of locomotives they got, as long as they worked. Mm-hmm. And so what happens is that the U.S. government actually forces some sort of standardization to locomotive production, because prior to that, each railroad company that ordered a locomotive they basically told, you know, the locomotive company, this is what we want. Mm-hmm. And almost every company, railroad company out there, had its own specific locomotive and specifications. So you're talking a very specialized business, and the U.S. government kind of changed that to a certain extent.
In World War II, there was more of that, and I'm thinking of tanks as well.
Well, World War II, it's a different animal, because what ends up happening is the War Production Board in World War II, you had several different companies that were still making locomotives, but you have new technologies that were coming online. Prior to World War II, starting in the 1920s and then into the 30s, there was a lot of experimentation with diesel locomotives. Matter of fact, GE, Ingersoll Rand, and ALCO pioneered diesel locomotive designing in the 1920s. And it was kind of seen as a way for smoke abatement rules in bigger cities, because steam obviously produces a lot of smoke, and in bigger cities, especially New York City, turning to diesel looked like a possibility for, you know, a cleaner environment. And, you know, so ALCO and GE and Ingersoll Rand experimented with that, produced a couple box locomotives. But then in the 30s, ALCO actually introduced the first standard production diesel locomotive switcher, mm-hmm. which was the HH600 and 660 series. But at the time, in the 1930s, though, steam was still king. You know. But then there's a company that comes out of nowhere that's owned by General Motors Corporation called the Electromotive Division, or the Electromotive...
Something like that.
Yeah, it's the Electromotive... EMD. Mm-hmm. I can't remember what the D stands for. I don't know why. But what happens with EMD is they start producing diesel locomotives for long hauling, for freight and passenger service on mainline, not just in yards and stuff. But what EMD does is it brings automobile production to locomotive production. You know, World War One, you know, the locomotive industry could see what standardization could do. Mm-hmm. But EMD is like, look, we can build hundreds of locomotives if you give us the opportunity. And they were much better at producing on a mass scale. They basically had a diesel locomotive that worked for pulling freight. And when World War II started, what the War Production Board basically did is it told EMD, you produce your road diesels, told ALCO, you produce your switching diesels, and ALCO, you still produce steam engines, because we don't want too much experimentation, because we need what works right now. And so what ends up happening is that during the war, ALCO produced smaller diesel engines, but its main focus was producing big steam engines. Mm-hmm. And then EMD was able to run with the diesel locomotive for freight and passenger service on the main lines.
And that's why ALCO didn't fare as well after World War II?
Yeah, essentially, because the other thing you got to remember too is that the War Production Board is making sure that all the country's resources are going to the war effort and things that we need immediately. So there was a lot of diesel experimentation that ALCO would have liked to have done, and they couldn't do because the War Production Board essentially said, you can't spend the money on that. You know, we want you to spend money on improving steam locomotives and things of that nature. And it did affect it, because what that meant is that in the post-war world, the diesel locomotive was the future, and EMD had a huge head start on ALCO. You know, and it's kind of sad, because ALCO was the one that did a lot of the innovation, and it seems like other companies were always able to take what they had started and run with it beyond where ALCO could go. There always seemed to be something ALCO was tripping over, if you ask me. Mm-hmm. So,
when was ALCO at its peak number of employees?
That would have been during World War II.
During World War II.
Yeah, because not only during World War II were they still building steam locomotives and switching diesels, but they were building tanks. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, the American Locomotive Company was producing the M3 series of tanks, which for any World War II buffs, it wasn't a great tank by any means, but the chassis itself had a reliable engine and a reliable suspension system and could be the basis of many other pieces of equipment. And in 1941, the United States Army set out, put out a requirement for a vehicle that was armored and could carry an artillery piece. Not a tank, but they wanted a cannon that would be armored so they could move around on the battlefield and take some shelling. And they put the requirements out there, and the American Locomotive Company, in 19 days, using the M3 chassis, which hopefully you can see a picture, what happens is in 19 days, the American Locomotive Company came up with one of the most revolutionary designs in mobile artillery, which is the M7 Priest. Mm-hmm. And they produced, I think in the end, they produced about 1,000 of those. I'm not 100% sure. But they design it, they produce it. Other locomotive producers are producing the ALCO-designed M7 Priest. And it played such a crucial role in World War II at the Battle of El Alamein. The British essentially felt that the M7 was a decisive influence on the battlefield at one of the most important battles of World War II, which was the Battle of El Alamein, where Rommel was essentially defeated, and it's the beginning of the end in North Africa. And the British were so thankful for that effort that they actually had a tank day in 1943 where the British government thanked the city of Schenectady, and they put on a big parade. And you know, if the Queen herself could have come, she couldn't come, but they sent a representative from the embassy to thank the people of Schenectady and ALCO for helping them win a major battle.
And then what happened in the 50s and the 60s?
A general slump after any conflict. What you find is that an economy will go through a slump because the government's not spending money anymore. Mm-hmm. And there was a brief slump in the economy after World War II. But it started to pick up again a year or two after the war, at least for locomotive builders, because a lot of the railroads, their equipment was worn out. Mm-hmm. They didn't have, they wanted to transition from steam to diesel because they could see that that was the wave of the future. And the problem for the American Locomotive Company was they weren't really prepared for it. They had a design. They tried to experiment. They were given permission during the war to experiment with an engine that ended up being what they called the 241. They designed it so fast that when they put it out in these locomotives that were known as the Black Marais. They were only one off. You know, they were basically to test this engine, and it was a disaster. I mean, they were in a rush. They were trying to catch up to EMD. You know, you get some rail fans who believe ALCO was behind the curve. No, ALCO knew what was coming. They just didn't have the ability to do what they needed to do. And so they rushed it. The engine was a disaster. So then they go back to the drawing board and, you know, they go back and rush the design of another engine, the 244.
What year are we in then?
You're talking this is 1944 or 45. Mm-hmm. And the 244 was rushed. I mean, they didn't rush it as much as the 241. But it had teething problems because what ALCO realized is they had to put a locomotive out to compete against EMD. EMD had been building diesel, long-haul diesels, throughout World War II, and, you know, with the FT series is what it's called. And ALCO knew it had to catch up.
But it never did.
It never could, because, you know, EMD was able to capture the market during the war. You had a lot of maintenance pools in a lot of railroads throughout the country were already comfortable working with EMDs because that's what they did during the war. And the other thing is, let's face it, GM at the time was one of the largest corporations in the world. They're coming out of World War II. I mean, how much money did the United States government, the British government, give them? Billions of dollars? They're the richest company in the world, and how could ALCO compete with that?
And GM was making the EMDs?
Yeah, the EMD was part of GM, and so ALCO really didn't have a chance. They did maintain themselves as the second largest producer of locomotives in the country throughout the 50s. Mm-hmm. And you had other companies that were trying to produce locomotives too. You had like Fairbanks Morris, which is a famous producer of engines that are still around. I mean, they still produce motors today. And as a matter of fact, in a great irony, they actually own the rights to ALCO's diesel engines today. Mm-hmm. But you also had, for example, Baldwin and Lima Hamilton were trying to make diesel locomotives, but nobody could catch up with EMD. And by the end of the 1950s, it's literally EMD and ALCO. At first, when ALCO was producing diesel locomotives, they were in conjunction with GE. ALCO made the chassis, the body, and the diesel engines, and then all the electrical components came from GE. But I guess in 1953, the two biggest companies in Schenectady, ALCO and GE, had a falling out. Mm-hmm. There were a lot of teething problems with ALCO's diesels, and GE probably wouldn't want to admit this, but a lot of them had to do with their electronics and their turbochargers, and then a lot of it had to do with ALCO's engine design itself. And they just kind of pointed fingers at each other and were blaming each other all the time for the problems, and they finally fell out in 1953. And that's what ends up spelling the doom of the American Locomotive Company, because what ends up happening is that over the course of the end of the 1950s, GE will get into the locomotive business. And of course, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out where did they get all of their information on long-haul diesels from working with ALCO. And then ALCO, in one of their, you know, again, you just know the company's doomed. They can't make their own electronic components, so that even though they're no longer ALCO GE diesel locomotives, all the electronics are still GE. And so anytime that ALCO built a new locomotive, there were GE technicians testing the electrical equipment on their locomotives, mm-hmm. on ALCO locomotives, which means then they go back to GE. And of course, you know, so it was just a matter of time.
Yeah. And when did things finally slow down and come to an end here in Schenectady?
Well, before they slowed down, I just wanted to point out that there were other problems too, and it's there are really bad labor problems, you know, labor management problems in ALCO. World War II was the peak years of production and employment at ALCO, and obviously from after the war it goes down. But what ends up happening is that, and if there's a lot of people from Schenectady watching this, they're not going to like this.
I'm sure there are.
that makes sense. You had unions that didn't realize that ALCO could actually close eventually. I mean, ALCO had been here for so long, you know, you had a labor force who felt that they needed to get as much out of the company as possible. And what ends up happening is you get a management that wants to squeeze as much out of the labor as possible. But the reality was you get to a point in the 1950s where management's trying to tell the workers there really isn't that much work, you know, and the workers don't want to hear that. As a matter of fact, right up until the very end, like the labor unions were trying to squeeze as much as possible out of the company, and you're like, and you just sit there and you're amazed that they expected to get more when it's the orders for locomotives. I mean, the factory must have been almost dead, mm-hmm. you know. And then right up until the end, the unions were negotiating with management, and finally, management just told them we're closing. And even then, I don't think they believed them until they realized they really meant it. And then all of a sudden, the unions were like, well, what are you going to do with our pensions? And their negotiating stance said, what can we save? You know, finally, it was like, what can we save? Like, we finally believe you. But by the time they did, it was too late.
And when was that?
That was in 68. And the final production is 69, but in January, were two locomotives.
I know, I believe it was 2 years ago, we had an exhibit downstairs in the Broman Room. And we are upstairs on the second floor of the Schenectady Museum right now in what is a ALCO exhibit room. When you planned the program 2 years ago, was it 2 years ago or 3 years ago?
2 years ago.
Tell us about the response you got from the people of the community. Obviously, did you think you would get that overwhelming a response from people?
I was actually really surprised because I kind of did it as something to do, you know, because it's, you know, being a historian, I love history and I like to get as much information out to the people as possible. And I just thought it was a shame there's nothing to ALCO in the city at all. You know, it's one of the most important companies in the history of the United States, let alone the history of the world. I mean, they helped win a major battle of World War II. And the response, I was surprised. So when I did the exhibit, I kind of thought, you know, maybe some people would be interested. But I ended up having the opportunity after doing the exhibit. I mean, I talked to, I guess I'm friends with one of the foremost, you know, ALCO historians in the country. Dick Steinbrenner, and you can buy his book, which is ALCO Centennial. It's a great book. You know, and then members of the rail fan community, it surprised me. People came out of the woodwork, and a lot of published people, too. I was surprised. It was kind of neat. And you had a lot of, you know, railroad historians who provided me with information and artifacts. And then the coolest part is that people from the community started to come out and actually produce things like, hey, this was my name tag from 1946, you know, and you want to put that in the exhibit. You know, I went over to the Effner History Center, and they had all these documents. They actually have, at the Effner History Center, the order book for the Schenectady Locomotive Works, and you can see the order for the Jupiter in there, which is, of course, the steam locomotive that met at the Transcontinental Railroad. And then you had workers who were coming out and telling me what it was like to work at ALCO. And we had people who worked for ALCO that came and did programs for us as well. Mm-hmm. And I want to put out there that if you know people who worked for ALCO or, you know, have stories about ALCO, to come down to the Schenectady County Historical Society, because Catherine, the librarian, is doing an oral history program with that, that if you come down, she'll record you and do interviews with you so that we can save that history.
Now, you're also involved in a local group that is hoping, planning on building some kind of ALCO museum, perhaps.
It's the ALCO Historical and Technical Society. We started 2 years ago at a diner. There was two of us over a cup of coffee and I think an omelet of some sort. But anyways, we decided that what we wanted to do is create some sort of museum in the Schenectady area to keep the memory of ALCO alive. And our goal is to acquire, as many of the buildings at the plant site as we possibly can and create a museum to the story of ALCO. Not only just talk about the story of ALCO, though, but also the industrial history of Schenectady through the story of ALCO. I don't think people are aware of the fact of just how important to the industrial history of the United States this area was, and I think that's important. So if we could acquire a couple of the buildings, we've already had some offers of some locomotives that are quite historic. One of the offers that we have was actually one of the last locomotives built in Schenectady. And then we also have the offer an offer for one of the first diesel production locomotives that was built here in Schenectady. And I was joking around that we kind of would have the alpha and omega of diesel production at the ALCO plant here in Schenectady.
Can we pinpoint what was the last steam locomotive built here?
Yeah, the last steam locomotive was built for the heck is the line? The PLE. I can't, the Pittsburgh and Lake Erie Railroad. There's a picture of it in the exhibit that's here somewhere. I don't remember the class numbers. I'm not a real big steam guy. But it was built, if I remember right, 1948.
And is it out there somewhere?
No, that's gone.
It's demolished or wrecked or whatever?
Yeah, a lot of the steam locomotives were scrapped. They were worth more scrapped than they were sitting in a museum piece. Mm-hmm. You can go out there, though, and there are still ALCO steam locomotives that are functioning. The Union Pacific actually has a functioning Challenger that they send out once in a while, which was one of the second largest steam locomotive ever built in the world. It's a whole series known as the Challengers, and it can still haul freight. They fixed it up, they spent the money, and it's part of their heritage, and they'll send that out, and it's amazing.
Tell us a little bit about the Big Boy. What exactly was that?
The Big Boy, it was a series of locomotives built for the Union Pacific that was the largest locomotives, steam locomotives ever built in history. They're massive. They were 4884s, which is the wheel configuration, mm-hmm. and they were just massive in size and scale, and they pulled a lot of freight. Them and the Challengers pulled a lot of freight.
What time frames are we talking?
Talking late 1930s and the 1940s. Mm-hmm. If I remember right, your Challengers and your Big Boys were actually still hauling freight into the early 1960s because they were still that powerful where they gave diesel a run for its money on the mountain, on the Rocky Mountains. Mm-hmm. So,
why is it you think that people are so fascinated with railroads?
Not sure. Probably because we all played with toy trains when we were kids, and then some of us still do. So. I don't know. It's just one of those things that I couldn't even tell you why. I drive by the Delaware and Hudson, I see a train, I'm 36 years old, and I still jump up and down, and it doesn't hurt that my kid's in the back yelling that, how amazing it is. But I really don't know. I just think it's because they're big, they're loud, but at the same time, some of them are actually quite beautiful to look at. Men like mechanical stuff too, and they're definitely, I don't know. I really couldn't tell you. My wife would probably like to know why.
Matt Zembo from Hudson Valley Community College, thank you for spending some time with us today.
Yeah, cheers, thank you.